Thanks for joining me. I'm Teresa Snow with this in-depth conversation with Focus on Your Health. I'm with Dr. Joel Shenker, a neurologist at MU Healthcare, making headlines, of course, a new Alzheimer's drug. Tell me about it.
This is the first drug we've had for Alzheimer's disease, a new one since 2003. And it's the first drug that works in a totally different way and actually targets one of the pathways that clearly does cause a brain damage problem in the brain.
You're optimistic about it.
I'm optimistic but cautious. The optimism is that this drug clearly does affect one of the pathways that damages the brain in Alzheimer's disease. It's a pathway that many have argued is not only something that happens in the disease but causes some of the symptoms. This drug clearly helps that. The cautious part is we really don't quite know for sure whether it helps. By metaphor, we don't know if this drug is going to simply make Alzheimer's disease still there but look less bad on an autopsy, or will this make symptoms get better? So as I get older, my hair gets gray, but if I had a treatment that my hair not get gray, doesn't mean I'm not going to get older. So if we were to do the same kind of thing in Alzheimer's, well, who the heck cares? So in this study, there were some patients, not everyone, who did seem to benefit by altering this pathway. So what the FDA said is, gosh, this is a common disease, it's a bad disease, it lasts a long time. While we're sorting this out, since there's reason to think it might help, let's go ahead and start using it. And if it turns out that it was helpful, then a lot of people will be better off.
Are you concerned about that approval process, though? It's on the heels of the vaccine that we're all taking for the pandemic and COVID-19, that there have been questions about the approval process. And now here's another drug with questions. How do you compare and contrast those?
That's worthy of a significant amount of concern. So there's an advisory panel that the FDA uses to tell them what drugs should we use. And that panel actually said, we don't think this drug is ready yet. The FDA decided to approve the drug anyway. They did it with the special exception that we have always made special exceptions for diseases that are very bad, very symptomatic, and what they're doing is what's called a phase 4 study. So in those situations, the FDA says, we're going to give temporary approval. Let's go ahead and use it. We think it's safe enough to use. There's enough reason to believe it could be helpful, but we're going to make you do a phase 4, an extra study, to really be sure, does this drug help? So the FDA basically said, we take everyone's opinions into account. We understand that there's controversy here. Let's find out for sure. But while we're doing that, since there's enough reason to be optimistic, let's start using it while we do those studies.
And as you said, Alzheimer's affects a lot of people. It's bad enough. It lasts a long time. But that controversy is different than the one with the COVID-19 vaccine.
Right. Well, that's also it's a very different kind of approval process. The Project Warp Speed, I think it was called, mainly made the vaccine be approved faster by avoiding a lot of the business analysis and forms that had to be filled out. It did not allow them to cut out any of the science. So the science was done the same way, and we were able to get enough information to know the vaccine would be effective. The controversy there has more to do with the speed with which it was done, but not the efficacy.
And not the science, as you mentioned.
That's correct.
Yeah, okay.
This drug, it's more about, is it effective?
And if you start giving it, do you feel like you've got those safeguards in place to say, I'm not seeing results with the patient, it's becoming unsafe, I'm going to pull back because of side effects?
Yes, but we need to be careful about what we say about that. There are ways to monitor people as they take this drug. There have to be special brain scans. There can be a certain amount of brain bleeding. There can be a certain amount of brain swelling. Our brain scans will help us know if that's happening. The whole goal is to start the drug at a low dose and slowly increase it. The scans let us know that we're doing that safely. The tricky part is you say, gosh, how do we know that it's helping? The people that were helped, the data showed, were helped because they failed to decline as much. Which is a big thing. The problem that you're going to have as a patient is, my gosh, I'm worse today than I was 3 years ago. What you're not going to know is how much more worse you were supposed to have been. So that's the part you're not going to be able to notice on an individual basis. That's why we need to do a study with many thousands of people to know for sure, is this really interrupting the course of the disease?
Tell me how it's given. It's not a simple pill.
No, it's an IV infusion. People have to get that once a month, and they have to come to an infusion center and get the drug given. It takes an hour or two to do that. There's special tests that need to be done beforehand to make sure they actually have this brain damage pathway in the brain for the drug to help. And then they'll have to have that monitoring with special brain scans after they start so that we can be sure it's not causing harm.
Do you know how soon MU Healthcare in your practice will be able to use this drug and recommend it?
So my bet is that will still be weeks to months away, but I think probably by the end of the year at some time, maybe by early next year, we'll be having people on the drug, both maybe as part of the Biogen study, but also just because your regular doctor has decided to start you on it.
So for the rest of us who are concerned about aging, Alzheimer's, dementia, what should we be doing?
Well, you need to continue to watch the news and see what transpires as we collect more data about this drug. What we should be doing otherwise is the same stuff we would have been telling people to do for their health in general. We have data to show that your long-term cognitive outcomes, whether you get dementia or how much it progresses, are benefited by these things. Number one, you stay cognitively active. It's all the stuff your mother would have told you to do.
Crossword puzzles.
Crossword puzzles. Read a book. Do something intellectual. Don't just sit on the couch all day. Number two, physical activity. Again, mom, I'm not going to have you sit on the couch all the time. Go run around and get some exercise and get some sweat. Number three, nutrition. We think that a diet that has a lot of variety with fresh fruits and fresh vegetables, so-called Mediterranean diet as one example, actually has cognitive benefit. Number four, good sleep. It turns out good sleep hygiene not only makes you feel better the next day, it's good for your health and it's good for the brain. In fact, it, good sleep, affects this same pathway that this drug is trying to affect, and it affects it in a good way. Number five, here's a news alert, don't smoke. Cigarette smoking is bad for you, and another reason is dementia is more likely. And finally, alcohol. We think that alcohol in moderation or no alcohol at all is the best thing. But more than moderation, we think is not good for your health. Those are the things that you can do as individuals. Finally, your doctor can do things. We know that aggressive control of blood pressure, or even something like getting your regular yearly flu shot or pneumonia vaccines if the doctor recommends it, these things also make it less likely that you get a dementia disease. So these are the things that you can do.
Take good care of yourself.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to back you up one more time before we wrap it up. Somebody calls you on the phone. They know you're a neurologist at MU Healthcare and you're the expert. What do you tell them about the new drug?
I would tell them, come in the office and let's talk it out. We should consider it. If you have Alzheimer's disease, especially if it's on the milder side, we should look into whether this is a drug that's a good fit for you. We should consider doing some of the tests to see if you have that particular damage pathway. And if everything checks out, I would consider putting you on the drug.
And you'll be safely monitoring them throughout the process.
That's right.
Thank you very much, Dr. Joel Shenker, MU Healthcare. With Focus on Your Health and this in-depth interview, I'm Teresa Snow. Have a great day.